thank you. Thank you very much for being here. As Megan said, for our last Living History program this year, the video you just saw gives you a sense of the program series we have in store for you next year. So these stories continue as the museum continues to gather these stories from people all over the world. One of my jobs as associate curator is to manage our ongoing oral history project, and we've captured over 1,300 interviews with people from around the world about their memories of the life, death, and legacy of President Kennedy and the history and culture of the 1960s. So if you have a story that you'd like to share with us, it's really easy. Just visit our website, jfk.org. We can do a video interview here at the museum if you're local. And if not, we can easily do a telephone interview. And you can be part of this story that we continue to tell more than half a century after the assassination of President Kennedy. We like to feature very special guests as part of this Living History program so that they can share their story with an audience and then let our audience become oral historians and ask questions of our guest speaker. Gene Boone is a good friend of this museum. He's done a lot of programs with us over the years. He was a Dallas County Deputy Sheriff for 10 years, 1962 to 1972, and is best known as the man who found the rifle on the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository on November 22nd, 1963. So we're going to talk about that, and we're going to talk a little bit about his memories of President Kennedy and the time period. So please join me in welcoming Gene Boone to share his story today. Thank you. Gene, here you are, 1962, right after joining the Dallas County Sheriff's Department.
Yes, you notice I was somewhat thinner then.
Well, this is at the beginning of your 10-year law enforcement career, and it's worth noting you were the youngest deputy sheriff ever hired by Bill Decker. Tell us about that.
That's correct. Prior to that, I was working for the Dallas Times Herald in the advertising department, and one day I had always been interested in law enforcement, so I just decided to go down and talk to the sheriff and see if I could go to work for him. I went down and talked with him, and he said, "Well, son," he said, "I'll check you out, and if we don't find any skeletons in your closet, I'll give you a call." So about 2 weeks later, he gave me a call. Won't know. I think it was on like a Thursday or Friday. Won't know if I come go to work Monday. Mm-hmm. I said, "No, I can't come go to work Monday. I've got to give at least 2 weeks' notice." He said, "Well," he said, "I'd expect that too." He said, "Okay." So we came in then about 3 weeks later.
Right. And the sheriff we're talking about is this man right here, Bill Decker, who was a legendary lawman. He pursued Bonnie and Clyde and has a storied history. Tell us a little bit about Bill Decker, the man. What was he like to work for?
He was real approachable. He was a legend, really, in his own time, but he was approachable by ordinary citizens, by people passing through town, by the deputies that he hired over the years. He served as a chief deputy for I don't know how many years. This was prior to World War II. He was chief deputy. Smoot Smith was the sheriff. And then after the war, war heroes came home. Steve Guthrie ran against Smoot Smith and displaced him. He served 2 years, and Decker then ran against him in 1948 and was a sheriff up until he died. Mm-hmm. He had a heart and a feel for Dallas County. And he was at home with a beggar coming through town or a bank president. And he was a legend in his own time.
And he clearly saw something special in you, giving you your chance at a law enforcement career.
Well, he did, I guess. I quit one time for about 3 months, and he said, "You'll be back." And so about 3 months later, I came back. He said, "I knew you'd be back." And so he put me back to work.
Let's jump ahead to that fateful weekend, November 22nd, 1963. We're looking at a picture of the president in Fort Worth that morning. Now, you've read quite a lot about this, and you have some thoughts about President Kennedy and why he was visiting Texas. So sort of set the scene for us with what you know.
Well, I'd been associated with the Democratic Party in the state of Texas for a number of years. Even though I was as young as I was still associated in that. And to kind of set the stage, you have to understand that Texas was heavily Democratic at that time, as heavily Democratic as it is Republican today. And the 1960 presidential nomination, Democratic nomination for president, was a bitter fight between he and Lyndon Johnson. Lyndon Johnson was running against him for the Democratic Party nomination, and it was a bitter contest back and forth. All through the campaign, Johnson had always said that he would never accept the vice presidential nomination. Well, it came down to the convention, and President Kennedy, even though he hadn't announced his campaign, had his thoughts on the 1964 presidential run again. He knew that he could not win the election without carrying Texas. And in order to carry Texas, he had to repair the damage that has been done in the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party was in shambles in the state of Texas. Liberals led by Senator Ralph Yarborough and conservatives led by moderates and conservatives led by Governor John Connally were just at one another's throat. As a matter of fact, Johnson and Ralph Yarborough, Senator Yarborough, wouldn't even ride in the same car at one point in time.
All these people you're talking about are visible in this picture we have. There's Ralph Yarborough right there, Congressman Jim Wright of Fort Worth, and then there's Governor Connally back there, of course, President Kennedy, and then the Vice President Lyndon Johnson.
And Congressman Wright at that time was Speaker of the House. No, I'm
not
sorry,
at that time.
Sam Rayburn was the Speaker of the House. During the nomination, as Kennedy said, he would never, Johnson said he would never accept the vice presidential nomination. Mm-hmm. An attorney here in town who was close in on Democratic politics, later ambassador to Russia and served in various capacities in the Democratic Party, told me that Johnson would not accept it until he talked to Sam Rayburn. Sam Rayburn called him the night of the convention and said, "You better take that job, boy. That's the only way you're ever going to get to be president." Now, people have made all kinds of things out of that after
sure.
the fact, but it does seem rather curious.
Knowing what you knew at that time, were you concerned at all that Kennedy would not be welcome in Dallas, that there might be some hostility towards him?
It was kind of a feeling up and down the street that morning. I had spent my district in Dallas was downtown Dallas, and that morning I'd spent some time up at City Hall, which was at Harwood and Main Street at that time. There was some concern within the police department that there might be, but there hadn't been anything visible other than the full-page ad that ran in the morning paper and the efforts that had been expended by the John Birch Society and some by Texas oil man Hunt, Lamar Hunt. But there was nothing really visible on the street in that way. But it was a concern nonetheless.
Well, you didn't have an assignment that day related to the president's visit, but you were able to see the parade. In fact, this is a great picture taken by bystander Phil Willis. And in this picture, we can't see you, but we can certainly see where you were standing. You were, this is 505 Main Street, where the sheriff's office was. And so you were out here on the street as the motorcade passed by. Tell us about that.
I was standing there with some other officers. If you go over there and look, there's some double doors that come down the steps, and we had come out, and I was standing on the curb with some other officers, and we were talking about the parade, and the limousine came down and made a right turn on Houston Street mm-hmm. and a left turn on Elm Street, mm-hmm. and the rest of the procession continued on down the street, and I heard the shots fired. The first shot that was fired, it wasn't any question in my mind but what it was a shot, and I began to run toward the triple underpass down Main Street.
Now, why did you run there?
Because that's where the sound of the shots were, and I knew that's where the presidential car was,
okay.
the motorcade. And so by the time I had gotten across Houston Street, the third shot had been fired as I came around the cement abutment there on the west side of Houston Street. I looked to my right as I came around that, and there were two people on the ground. And I thought to myself, there's two dead ones right there. As I got closer, they began to get up. And I was asking bystanders in there, where did the shots came from? And nobody knew exactly where the shots had come from.
We're going to watch some home movie footage shot by Robert Hughes while you continue to tell your story. Okay.
As I came around the abutment there, I noticed some motorcycles on the street. The presidential car was just entering the triple underpass. I ran across the grassy area between Main Street and Elm Street, across Elm Street, and up what's been referred to as the grassy knoll. There was a motorcycle officer in front of me. I helped him over the fence. He pulled me over the fence where the bridge and the fence come together there in the corner. He pulled me over the fence. He went to the south over toward the post office annex, and I went out into the freight yard.
Okay, and that's what we're looking at right there, that glimpse. Now, let's just for a moment, before we go further, let's go back to those shots. You heard three shots fired. Did any of them sound closer together? What was the spacing that you recall?
As I recall, it was bang, bang, bang. And after the fact, I've had opportunities to analyze that. There was a period from the first shot to the last shot of 8 seconds. And it seemed to me like the second and third shots were closer together than the first shot and the second shot.
And they were all uniform, sounded like they came from the same direction?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So let's pick up the story. You're over here behind the grassy knoll area, the stockade fence, in the freight yards where the Pullman cars are. Pick up the story there. What are you seeing?
There's some Pullman cars there, and in a situation like that, you're looking for something that doesn't belong there. And so I was looking through and around the freight cars that they had back there, and on a landing between two cars, and I heard something coming down the side of the Pullman car, and I had pulled out my pistol. I carried a .45 automatic, and as it came abreast of the landing that I was on, it was a porter, I guess, that had been working in one of the Pullman cars. And as he came abreast of the landing that I was on, he was looking right down the barrel of my .45. And I said, hold it. And all he could say was, I, that's all he could say. And so I was soon able to determine that he didn't have anything to do with the assassination, that he had been working back there. And then I moved over toward where the spectators were up around the front of the school book depository.
Okay. A couple things, though. When you first got around there, you looked over by the area of the stockade fence where so many theories place a second gunman that day. Is there anything you can tell us that might lend credence to the possibility of there being a gunman back there?
Well, prior to that, I had talked with Mr. Bowser, who was in the railroad control tower.
Yeah, Lee Bowers.
And I asked him if he had seen anybody running in the area or seeing anything that was out of place. He advised that he didn't see anything and that he had not heard any shots. So then I went back toward the school book depository and searched the area along the grassy area there where the hedge was and the fence area back to where the bridge abutment came together. I didn't see anything to cause me to believe that there was anybody had fired a shot from that area. I believe if somebody had fired from the hedge area, they would have had to be standing in the flower bed in order to do that. The grassy, the area there had recently been turned and everything had been beautified. The whole area had been beautified because of that. And there was just a crust that forms over freshly turned dirt. And that dirt was not disturbed. And so I surmise from that nobody was standing in the flower beds doing any shooting from that.
Okay. Let's take another look at another picture here at the front of the Texas School Book Depository. So you met up with a couple of eyewitnesses, the Betzners. Tell us about that.
W.H. Betzner and his wife were over on the Elm Street side, and he had taken some pictures, and I observed him with a camera And I asked him if he had taken any pictures. He said yes, and he thought he had taken some just before or about the time the shooting started. So I took he and his wife over to the sheriff's office, confiscated his camera, gave it to our identification bureau, who developed the film to try to determine if he had anything on his film or not. I think he and his wife made statements also at that time, and as it turned out, he didn't have anything of consequence on the film.
Was that the only eyewitness and the only camera that you were involved with that day after the shooting?
I think so.
Okay.
After that, I came back over to the school book depository. The upper floors of the school book depository, the lighting was real poor in there. And back in that day and time, you didn't have flashlights and LED lights like we have today. We had large battery-powered flashlights that had been brought over from the sheriff's office and were sitting on the front steps. I took one of those flashlights and with some other officers went to the sixth floor.
Now, before you had been searching outside over in the rail yards, so what brought you inside the depository?
The organized search at this point in time had really centered on the school book depository.
Okay. All right. And so the picture we're looking at is showing the sixth floor. In fact, the window that you see is the southeast corner sniper's perch window, looking at it from a distance. Tell us what that floor was like walking around there 51 years ago.
It was a mess. There was books stacked up. It seems like there was no uniform way the books were put up there. It was just randomly brought up there and stacked up. And so we lined up along the east wall of the sixth floor. And in a situation like that, you're looking for something that doesn't belong there. And so we began to search in, under, and around the books and what have you that was there. Officer Luke Mooney, a deputy, also found what's been referred to in the southeast corner of the school book depository, which has been referred to as the sniper's nest.
Yeah, here's a picture of that.
He said he found this sniper's nest, and so I went over, curiosity, I went over and took a look at it, and I saw a couple of cases of books stacked up that could be used for a rifle rest and a partially eaten chicken meal there. All of the officers on the floor, I think, went over and looked at that, and then...
When you say look, were they in any way, would you say, contaminating the crime scene?
No, I don't think so. Officer Mooney was trying to keep that area secure so the identification bureau could come in and analyze the situation and do any fingerprinting and what have you that they needed to do there. The rest of us went back to our search areas, and as I came across the building to the northwest corner, which is where the stairwell is in the northwest corner, yep. I was against the windows on the north, on the west side of the building, and I looked down and shone my light. There were two rows of books, two cases high. The top row of books on the outside toward the stairwell had been pushed across the top of a crevice between the two rows of books. And in that crevice between the two rows of books is where I saw the rifle.
So does this picture look familiar to you as what you saw
yes,
that day?
Yes.
Okay, so tell us again where the rifle was.
The rifle was in the crevice between the two rows of books.
So right down in this area right
yes.
here. Okay.
Yes. And I said, here's a rifle. And my police training clicked in, and I looked at my watch. It was 1:22 in the afternoon. That I observed that, and then I protected the officers came over to look and see, and I tried to protect the scene also and call for the identification bureau to come and photograph and fingerprint the area.
Okay, so this is a crime scene photo. The pictures we've been looking at so far are Dallas police crime scene photographs. So there's the rifle as you found it, and that looks exactly the way it looked to you as you came across it?
Yes.
Okay. And then here we have a news photograph from the Dallas Times Herald. That's Lieutenant Carl Day of the crime lab pointing to where the rifle was found. Now, this is where the story gets a little complicated because you identified the rifle. Tell us about that.
People were asking about the rifle. What did it look like? I said it looked like a Mauser Mauser really referring to bolt-action weapon. As it turned out, it was an Italian Carcano bolt-action weapon. And so there's been some
controversy.
Talk about it, controversy about that. But the rifle that I saw was the rifle that Lieutenant Day extracted from the crevice, and as it turned out, it was an Italian Carcano rifle. This time, there were a lot of surplus military weapons, both German and Italian, on the market that could be purchased for little or nothing. Mm-hmm. And so that's what it looked like.
But there were some early reports that a German Mauser had been found in the building, and
there
then
were.
When it became apparent that an Italian Mannlicher-Carcano was found,
yes.
There has been theory suggesting maybe there were two rifles found
yes.
in the building.
No, there weren't two rifles. That was the same rifle. I was mistaken.
Okay.
Now, it pains me to say that.
How old were you at
With
the time?
My wife sitting here on the front row. It pains me to say that, but it's true. I was 24 years old.
You were 24. You had been a deputy sheriff for a little over a year at this time?
About a year, a little over a year, yes.
Yeah. And you were suddenly thrust into investigating the assassination of the President of the United States. What was going through your head that day as you're up there on this dusty, dirty floor looking for evidence of the president's shooting?
Well, I guess numb really is the best way to describe that. I just feel numb by the magnitude of the events. The rumors that came back was that President Kennedy had been shot, that Governor Connally had been shot, that a Secret Service agent had been shot. And then it came back that President Kennedy was dead, that Connally was seriously wounded, and so on. So
right.
You had all of these rumors floating around, and the photographers and the press media, world press media, was on the location. And so there was just a lot of chaos, a lot of confusion.
And was there some emotion mixed in there, too?
I think there was some emotion mixed in there, too. There was a lot of anger. From the spectators in particular, a lot of anger, a lot of hurt, a lot of sadness. Mm-hmm. I went back to the sheriff's office and sat down at my typewriter and typed a report. Sheriff Decker.
We'll look at that in just a second, because it's coming up on the slides. This picture, a Dallas crime scene photograph of the rifle.
Yes.
This is the rifle you found.
It looks like the rifle that I found. And I say it looks like because it does look like that rifle, but I never handled the rifle. I never touched it. If I had handled it and touched it, I would have inscribed it with my initials to document that I had handled the weapon.
Well, we do have some silent black and white footage of the rifle being dusted for prints. And were you aware that there were media folks up on the sixth floor, news cameramen and photographers?
They were everywhere.
Right in the middle of that crime
Frankly,
scene.
Frankly, they were everywhere. They were all over. And they were the whole weekend. That mm-hmm. was, in my judgment, that was a weekend that changed the world.
Yeah. This was shown on WFAA Channel 8 on the day of the assassination and went around the world, so people got their first look inside the Texas School Book Depository. There's the sniper's nest in the southeast corner.
Mm-hmm.
You're really not visible in much of the footage or photographs taken that day, which is frustrating to researchers looking to find you there.
That's by design. I had several opportunities to talk to reporters and talk to the media. And I declined to do that and referred everybody to the sheriff. He was the spokesperson for the department. It was his responsibility. I shared that responsibility, but it was his responsibility. And I felt like any announcement or interview or what have you should come from him.
Okay. Well, you mentioned that you sat down and typed up a report, I've heard you refer to as a Dear Decker letter. We're looking at just a portion of it, sort of the abstract. It's actually a two-page document, which is now in our collection. We're very honored to have it here. There's some typos in this because you were really rushing to get this done as quickly as you could after finding the rifle.
I sure was.
Yeah.
I was trying to get it done and trying not to leave anything out and trying to do be as accurate as I could. He required what we called a Decker letter. Anytime there was any kind of incident on your shift, he required you to write a letter so he could have it on his desk. In the event that somebody called him and asked him about it, he'd have some recollection of what had happened. And mm-hmm. so that was the purpose of the Decker letter to start with, whether it was the assassination or whether it was a multiple accident that occurred out here on the highway somewhere. Right. He wanted to know about those things. And so that was the purpose of it, and I wanted to give him as much information as I had immediately. And then later I considered and redid it into a two-page
right.
into a two-page letter.
Did you talk to any employees of the Texas School Book Depository?
I don't think I talked to anybody.
Okay. Did you hear the name Lee Harvey Oswald at all while you were in the building?
I heard one of the secretaries had told one of the officers that was taking some interviews, saying, "I don't know if you know it or not, but Lee Oswald is not here." There was on this side of the building, there was as I recall, there was a chain link fence for parking on this side of the building. And all of the employees had been asked to exit the building and go over there, and were going to give interviews in terms of what they did and what they saw and where they were. And that's where I heard the name Lee Oswald. Mm-hmm. I knew that a broadcast went out on the police radio with his description on it.
Okay. One of the depository employees is here today. Where are you, Buell? Buell, stand up.
Right.
Buell Wesley Frazier worked with Lee Harvey Oswald and actually drove Oswald to work on November 22nd, 1963. Buell, let's recognize you for being here today. Stand up for us. Thank you very much for being here, another living legend in our museum today. Let's move ahead, Gene, to Sunday when Jack Ruby enters the picture shooting Lee Harvey Oswald. Now, let's start by, tell us where you were when Ruby shot Oswald that day.
The sheriff and myself, I had come back down Saturday and Sunday morning in the event that the sheriff needed me to do anything, needed me to run somewhere, some errands or something. So we had heard that the city was going to transfer him from the city hall, from the city jail, to the county jail. After he had been filed on, that's when they transferred to the county jail. The sheriff and myself and two or three other deputies were on Houston Street out behind the where the car could drive into the jail office. And so we were out there surveying the situation out there, and a deputy, I think, came running out from inside the office saying, "There's a fight at City Hall." Well, we began to go in the driveway to go back in the office, and before we could get in the office, they said, "There's a shooting. There's been a shooting at City Hall." As I came in the office, I came around a switchboard operator, and she looked at me and said, "You have a phone call." And I went to the phone, and it was my wife, Charmaine. And she said, "I've been watching this on TV," and she said, "It looked like Jack Ruby shot Oswald." I said, "No, it couldn't be Jack." And I told the sheriff, I said, "Charmaine just called and said it looked like Jack Ruby shot Oswald." He said, "No, it couldn't be Jack," but it was. I had known Jack for a number of years prior to my work with the sheriff's office. I was employed by the Dallas Times Herald, a newspaper that's no longer in existence. I handled all the theater and nightclub advertising in Dallas. Jack Ruby was one of my clients. And I had known Jack not real well, but I had known him we'd had many interchanges. He was what we called in the newspaper business cash with copy. In other words, you didn't take his ad unless you had the cash in hand to run that ad in that day's newspaper. At that time, Charmaine and I only had one car, and she many times brought me to work and came by and picked me up in the afternoon. And so most of the time I was waiting for Jack to bring his ad and his cash in that evening so he could get in the next day's newspaper. And she was waiting to take me home. And so she knew what he looked like as well. That's what caused her to see him on TV to say mm-hmm. it looked like Jack Ruby.
What was his personality like?
Jack was always looking for something different to put in at his club, his carousel club. He was located up on Commerce Street. There were two other burlesque houses in the same area. He occupied the upper floors of a parking garage in the carousel club. Across the driveway of the parking garage was Abe's Colony Club. And behind on Jackson Street was the theater lounge. Abe and Barney Weinstein owned the theater lounge and the Colony Club. Jack always felt like that they were trying to run him out of business, when in reality they couldn't have cared whether he was there or not. But I believe that your question may be, what do I think maybe prompted him to do that?
Sure.
I believe that Jack thought that he could shoot Oswald, be the man that shot the man, you know, the code of the West, and that no jury would ever convict him, and that he could go back and open his carousel club and be the main attraction and have more business than he could shake a stick at.
So you don't believe Ruby was in any way involved in a conspiracy or a plot?
I do not. That's not to say that I didn't believe that he didn't have any underworld connections, that he didn't know anybody, for example. But for him to be a pawn of the mafia or the underworld or anybody else, I don't believe that. I think it was self-motivated. I'm not sure that it was how premeditated it was. I think maybe it was a spur of the moment sort of thing. But I believe that's the way he thought. I knew his personal attorney for many years, an attorney by the name of Stanley Kaufman. And Stanley and I talked about it a number of times over the preceding years. And I just believe that's what his thinking was.
You testified to the Warren Commission, went to Washington and testified in 1964. What was that experience like
for you? In March of 1964. As a matter of fact, Luke Mooney and I both testified before the Warren Commission in the Veterans of Foreign Wars building. The day that they issued the new Kennedy half dollars. Two FBI agents had been there just before that, and they were telling me about it as they were leaving. And I bought two of those dollars from two of those. It wasn't silver dollars; it was half dollars.
Yeah.
I bought two of those from him, and
I
paid him. We traded dollars there for that. But that was the day that we testified before the Warren Commission.
All right. Well, I want to take some questions from the audience. If you have questions for Mr. Boone, if you'll write those down on your question cards, we will start to collect those. Gene, I mentioned at the start that you've been a good friend of ours for many years, and I want to show a picture from an exhibit we had up here on the seventh floor between 2006 and 2007 called Voices from History, Dallas Law Enforcement. And we're looking at your 45. We had that on display. And it's a beautiful weapon. Tell us about the little badge that's on the handle there.
I had those made. One of the deputies had been a jeweler before he was a deputy sheriff, and he had the resources to do that. And so I gave him a copy of, and they made a cast of my badge number 240. They made some miniature badges that we distributed around to the wives mostly in a bracelet form or a necklace form. And I took two of them and had those inset on the mother of pearl handles.
And that's the gun that you aimed in the face of the porter
yes.
out in the rail yards there.
It certainly is.
I can understand how that would be an intimidating thing.
I would suspect that I could do. We both were scared. I mean, yeah. he was really scared, and I was scared at the same time.
Yeah.
But as it turned out, it worked out.
Now, you've done a number of programs. I mean, we've had you here at the museum for lectures, for panel discussions, for oral histories. Is this something that after 50 years being known around the world as the man who found the rifle, is this something you get tired of talking about?
No, I really don't get tired of talking about it, but simply because my fear is that some of the, and I don't mean to insult anybody here today, some conspiracy theorist may be here that their thoughts many times don't coincide with what I saw and what I did, what I observed and experienced during that time. And so I would just like for people to get the idea of what really happened.
Mm-hmm. And how would you say this has impacted your life over the last half century, the places that you've gone, the interviews that you've done?
We had an opportunity in 1985 to go to England, and some of you may have seen the film On Trial, Lee Harvey Oswald. It was an eight-hour presentation that in 1985 marketed in this country on Showtime TV. It was shown in two nights in four-hour segments over the anniversary date of the assassination. Lee Harvey Oswald was represented in absentia by Jerry Spence, a lawyer from Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Some of you may not recognize the name, but he's the celebrity lawyer that you see that's white-headed and usually wore a leather coat with the fringe on his sleeves. I know he represented Nelda Marcus, and he represented over the years a number of celebrities. Vincent Bugliosi, who at that time was an assistant district attorney for the city of Los Angeles and had represented the city of Los Angeles, or the county, I should say, of Los Angeles in trials in 96 capital cases and had won 95 of them. Mm-hmm. He represented, or he prosecuted Manson, which I guess maybe is one of the most famous that he had, and he was the prosecuting attorney. There was a judge from Midland that was a federal judge from Midland that was the judge in that case. They brought jurors from Dallas, and they brought as many witnesses as they could from Dallas that could testify from that. I actually testified on that film the day that Andrew and Fergie got married. We've been in England for 10 days. And we really wanted to see the parade that occurred there with their marriage and what have you. And yet that day I was testifying in this long trial, and we didn't get to see it. We just saw it on TV.
I want to jump in because we have a lot of questions
okay.
here. First and foremost, one that I knew you were going to get asked, but what do you feel today, 2014, was there a conspiracy or did Lee Harvey Oswald act alone?
Yes and no. Number one, I feel that the Warren Commission was correct in its analysis of the evidence that had been presented to them, that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone in the assassination. So, lone shooter theory. However, I would hasten to say that it doesn't really make sense to me that here you have a shooter who was in the service. He was disgruntled in the service and was discharged on, I think, a general discharge. Later renounced his American citizenship and went to Russia. He was then he was dissatisfied with that, and he was observed in Cuba. He was observed in New Orleans as a political activist passing out materials. And all of a sudden, the president's coming to town, and you have him moving books around in the school book depository. Somehow that just doesn't make sense to me. I believe if there was a conspiracy, the conspiracy was to get him in the right place at the right time to accomplish such a feat.
There are a lot of questions here about one of your colleagues at the Sheriff's Department, Roger Craig.
Roger Craig.
And some observations that he made that day which have been controversial over the years.
Yes.
What can you tell us about Roger Craig?
Roger was a neat guy. He was a dispatcher with the sheriff's office. I liked Roger. We weren't bosom buddies. We just were acquaintances at the sheriff's office. I always found him to be honest with me.
What about what he observed that day about the Mauser and the Rambler station wagon, everything else?
I never saw anything like that around. I think the big problem with his testimony or the book that he's, or paper, whatever it is that he's written, I know that I haven't read it, but I know it's on the internet. I've seen it on the internet. That could not be corroborated. And one of the things that I think I see is that with the congestion that we had downtown, the only reasonable way that I see of somebody moving from the school book depository to Oak Cliff is back through the Continental, at that time, the Continental Street Viaduct, and then going on Beckley Street out to Oak Cliff, which would put him close to the apartment that he had over there. And now, whether he went in a taxi cab or whether it was the vehicle Roger saw or whether it was a bus, I can't answer that. I don't know.
Okay.
But that makes more sense to me than anything else, because from the time, and you have a better frame of reference than I do, from the time that he was captured over at the school in the Texas Theater, but we're talking about from the time the first shot was fired until he was apprehended, we're talking a couple of hours, less than 2 hours.
Yeah, really just about 90 minutes or so.
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty quick.
Yeah.
I knew J.D. Tippett. I didn't know him well, but I knew who he was. Mm-hmm. He was an 11-year veteran with the Dallas Police Department. It doesn't make sense to me that Lee that felt like that J.D. Saw somebody walking down the street that answered the general description that was given over the police radio. I believe he got out of his car and was walking in front of his car when Oswald shot him. I don't believe he knew or even remotely considered that it was somebody that had been a prospective assassin of the President of the United States, simply because the snap on his holster was not unsnapped. And I believe at very least he would have unsnapped the holster so he could get his gun out in a hurry if he needed to.
When you were in the rail yards after the assassination, did you see any other officers, any other spectators, or anyone that identified themselves as a government agent or Secret Service?
No, I did not.
Okay. So there weren't really anyone else?
I didn't see anybody. I just saw the porter that I talked to, and then I talked to Mr. Bowder in the control tower, and he didn't say that he saw anybody else out there. Had he seen somebody, I probably would have gone to try to find out who that was.
Did Sheriff Bill Decker order his deputies to stand down that day and not participate in security?
No. The interesting thing about that is when the Secret Service comes to town on a visit like this, you just respond to what they ask for. Mm-hmm. I mean, if he had asked for 10 men to do X, the sheriff would have provided 10 men to provide X. The Secret Service is in charge of the security of the president. You just provide whatever it is they need.
Anything more you can tell us about Lee Bowers, the switching tower operator?
I had a very short interchange with him. I just asked him if he saw anybody in the freight yard. He said he did not. I asked him if he'd heard any shots. He said he had not.
You know that Bowers later expanded his story.
That he heard something and saw something. I don't know what that was, but...
But right after the assassination, he told you he saw...
That's correct.
How do you feel that your misidentification of the weapon, calling it a Mauser instead of a Carcano, how do you feel knowing that that has prompted so much controversy and research over the years about that?
I'm sorry about it. I just think when you see a bolt action weapon, that really is a Mauser action. Mauser really refers to a bolt action. When you think Mauser, though, you think German, but it really refers to the action.
Mm-hmm. And we'll take one more question here. Over the years, have you ever been misquoted in any of the various books that you've appeared in?
Probably. I have not read much about it. A lot of times during a film series or what have you, I have asked for copies of that. Most of the time they've responded with that. I have it in a tub at home. My children are going to have to go through that one of these days and figure out what they want to do with some of that stuff. As far as I know, I haven't been misquoted or misled anything. And it's not my intention to mislead anybody about my part or anybody else's part that I knew about. I'm just trying to tell you what experience I've had and what I've observed and what conclusions that I have drawn from that.
All right, wonderful. Please join me in thanking Gene Boone for being our guest today.